Welcome to this episode of Real Chemistry. We're going to be talking about precipitation reactions. And precipitation reactions are just when you combine two aqueous chemicals, that is dissolved chemicals, and get out a solid chemical. So if we look here at this reaction, we're combining lead nitrate, which is aqueous, that's what this AQ means, or dissolved, with potassium iodide, also aqueous, or dissolved. And so they're both dissolved, and that's why up here they just look like clear solution. So it looks like you're adding two clear liquids together and you get out this yellow, right? So what's going on there? Well, that yellow is a solid and it turns out to be lead iodide. So when you mix together potassium iodide and lead nitrate, you get out a solid, lead iodide. And that's called a precipitation reaction because a solid is forming from two dissolved chemicals. Our goal in this video is going to be to predict the products of a precipitation reaction. So we'll look at combining two chemical species that are aqueous, and we're going to try to figure out what compounds form when they're mixed. Is there a solid? Now, the reason sodium chloride here and the other chemicals on the previous slide were listed as aqueous is because they're soluble. So both sodium chloride and silver nitrate are soluble. And what we're really looking for is when we combine those, will we get out something that's insoluble or a solid? And so you need to be comfortable using solubility tables. If you're not sure how to use a solubility table, check out my video on ionic compound solubility, and that'll help you with that part. All right, so how do we do this? How do we predict what the products will be if we combine sodium chloride and silver nitrate? Well, I've broken this process down into five steps. And the very first step we're gonna do is we're gonna determine the charges on all of our ions. And so here, we'll start off with sodium chloride. And we know that chlorine's minus one. Chlorine's always a negative one charge. And sodium is always a plus one charge. If you're not sure how I did that, go ahead and check out my video on predicting the charges of ions. And we can use the periodic table and their position on that table to know what the charges are. Over here, we have silver nitrate. And here you basically just have to remember that nitrate has a charge of negative one. If you don't know that, you really can't do this problem. So you have to know nitrate's a negative one. So it becomes pretty important to know the charges on your polyatomic ions. And that means silver is plus one. So that's step one. Now, step two is going to be switch the cations. What do I mean by that? Well, if we look over here, we have two cations. Sodium is a cation, it's positively charged, and silver is a cation, it's positively charged. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to take sodium and I'm going to put it where silver is. And I'm going to take silver and I'm going to put it where sodium is. Why am I doing that? Well, basically I'm testing all of the different types of compounds that could form when I mix those two things together. And the only compounds that can form are still pairing a positive charge with a negative charge. So for example, I couldn't have a compound that was two anions, and I couldn't have a compound that was two cations. So that's why this is the only switch that makes sense to do. We're gonna move silver over there and sodium over there, and we'll get the two compounds we could possibly form. So what that gives us on the other side then is silver chloride, and the charges just carry over. So our chloride is still minus one, and our silver is still plus one. And then when we put sodium where silver was, we get sodium nitrate. And sodium is still plus one, and nitrate is still minus one. Okay, now that we've switched the cations, we've just basically written out the products, and the products just have the same ions that we put in with the cations flipped. And now what we're gonna do is we're gonna balance the charges. We're gonna make sure that these compounds are neutral. In this case, you'll notice that silver's plus one and chlorine's minus one, so that's a neutral compound, and that sodium's plus one and that nitrate's minus one, so that's a balanced compound. So this is sort of an easy reaction to start with because our charges are already balanced, so we're done with that step. Now sometimes, let's say that you had a silver that was plus two, then you'd have to adjust the number of chlorines to make that neutral. All right, now what we're gonna do is we're gonna check for solubility. That's step four. And if it's soluble, we're gonna write aqueous. If it's insoluble, we're gonna write solid. And if both of those compounds are aqueous, we're gonna write no reaction. The reason that is that if they're both aqueous, we don't have a precipitation reaction. We're not forming a solid. So that means there's no reaction that occurs. We just have a mixture of ions floating around in a beaker. So let's go ahead and check for solubility. We'll start out with silver chloride. So we'll start out with silver chloride. And what we're gonna do is we're gonna go into our solubility tables and we're gonna look for silver or chlorine. And what we see is on the table listing soluble ions, we see chlorine right there. So chlorine ions typically are insoluble compounds, except when it's paired with silver, and silver plus one. So now you can see why it's important that we determine those charges. If we didn't know it was silver plus one, then we couldn't tell if this is soluble or insoluble. So chlorine compounds typically soluble, but not when paired with silver. And that means that our silver chloride's insoluble. And so we're going to put an S down there for solid. A little confusing there. Don't start to think that S means soluble. What it means is solid. That's the phase it's in. All right, so we know silver chloride is a solid. So already we know this is a precipitation reaction. Our real last question is, do we form two solids or one? So what's the phase on sodium nitrate? And here, we're going to go ahead and look for sodium or nitrate in our tables. And right at the top of this table on the right-hand side, we see nitrate. And there's no exception. So anything containing nitrate is soluble. And that means that we're going to write aqueous down here. So that's it. We have a precipitation reaction in this case. We're forming solid silver chloride and aqueous sodium nitrate. The last step, which is not necessary in this case, is balance the chemical reaction. You'll notice that we have the same number of silvers, chlorines, sodiums, and nitrates on both sides. So this reaction's already balanced. So let's take a look at another example. All right, in this case, we have sodium hydroxide mixing with copper bromide. And we're just going to go through these same steps. The first thing we're going to do is we're going to determine the charges. And here again, you need to know your polyatomic ions, and hydroxide is 1-. That's this whole guy here. That's hydroxide. And that means that our sodium is +1. Our bromine is -1. We know that from the periodic table. And we have two of them. So since there's two bromines at -1 each, that gives us a total negative charge of -2. And that means that we need a +2 for our copper. So now we've determined the charges. And now the next step is switch those cations, right? So we're going to take sodium and put it where copper is, and we're going to take copper and put it where sodium is. So now we're going to do step two. When we switch those cations, we're just going to write out our products using these same ions, but flip what ion cations written where. So we have copper hydroxide, because we're taking that copper and we're writing it where we saw sodium. And now the charges just carry over. So copper is still 2+, and hydroxide is still 1-. I recommend writing those charges as you go along, because they're going to be necessary in just a second. Now, what we're going to write is the sodium where the copper was. So NaBr. And bromine's still -1, and sodium's still +1. Notice I don't write Br2. I'm just gonna not specify how many bromines I have. The reason that is what determines how many bromines and how many sodiums I have is if those charges on that ionic compound are balanced. And that's step three, so balance charges. And notice that sodium and bromine have a charge of +1 and -1. And that means that sodium bromide's already balanced. On the other hand, copper 2+, is not balanced with our hydroxide. Hydroxide is just -1, and our copper is 2+. So what we're gonna need is we're gonna need two hydroxides. And the way you can think about that is you can think about it as in terms of crossing over. If you're not sure how to do this step, go ahead and watch Naming Ionic Compounds Part 1. We go through this process carefully of writing balanced ionic compounds. But basically, you can think about it as crossing over, where you take this 2 down here and this 1 down there, and that becomes the number of elements of each type that we have. I'm gonna erase those arrows. And so that means we have one copper, but two hydroxides. And whenever we have multiple polyatomic ions, we have to use our parentheses, because that's saying we have two whole hydroxides. All right, so that is step three. Now, step four, check for solubility. First, we're gonna look at copper hydroxide. And when we go and take a look through our tables, we'll notice at the very top of our table about insoluble compounds, we see hydroxide. So hydroxide's typically insoluble. Let's see if copper, which it's paired with, is one of the exceptions. And you notice you don't see copper anywhere in there. So in this case, our hydroxide is making our compound insoluble. So copper hydroxide is not soluble. That means it forms a solid. So once again, we have a precipitation reaction. We have copper hydroxide, which forms a solid. Now let's check out sodium bromide. Again, we'll see sodium in our tables. We see it right here under the things that are typically soluble, and there's no exception. So that means any sodium-containing compound is always soluble. So that means our sodium bromide is soluble, and that means we write aqueous. So we're done now, except for balancing the chemical reaction. That's the last step. Now I'm gonna leave you to balance this chemical reaction and check and make sure it's balanced. If you have any troubles balancing this reaction, go check out my video on balancing chemical reactions. All right, one more example problem. Here, we're going to combine iron chloride with sodium nitrate. And we're going to follow the same exact step. Step one, determine the charges. So we see here that we have chlorine. Chlorine we know is 1-. There's three of them, meaning we have a total of -3 from our chlorine, meaning our iron must have a total of 3+ to make it neutral. Then our nitrate, again, -1. And our sodium, +1. Okay, now let's switch the cations. So when we switch the cations, we're just switching the place of those two things that come up front. So we're going to put iron where we see sodium, and sodium where we see iron. So I'm going to write the first possible product, which is sodium chloride. And again, I'm not going to write how many chlorines I have. What's going to determine how many sodium and chlorines I have there is the charges. So I have sodium, which is still 1+. And I have chlorine, which is still 1-. You can see right away that's balanced. And now we have to write our iron where we saw our sodium. So I'm going to write iron nitrate. And again, that iron charge just carries over. So we see that we have a 3+ from our iron and a 1- from our nitrate. Now what we're going to do is we're going to balance those charges. Step three, balance the charges. So we can see right away sodium chloride has a +1 and a -1. That's balanced. Our iron nitrate, however, not balanced. So what we're going to need to do is go ahead and cross over that 3 and that 1 to create a balanced compound. And what that's going to do is it's going to take the +3 that's with iron, and that's going to go way down around the nitrate, and it's going to give us 3 nitrate groups. So that's the sort of trick way to get that compound balanced. But remember, what it's really saying is that if you have 3 things at -1 and 1 thing at +3, you have a balanced compound. All right, now last thing we're going to do, check for solubility. All right, sodium chloride, right away we see that sodium is in our things that are typically soluble with no exceptions. That means that it's aqueous. Now we're going to check out our iron nitrate. And our iron nitrate is also aqueous because nitrate is right up there in our things that are typically soluble. And that means that this guy is also aqueous. I kind of ran out of room, but I'll write the AQ there. And if they're both aqueous, remember, that means no solids formed. No solids formed in this reaction, so it's not a precipitation reaction. So instead of writing down these phases and leaving this as our final answer is no reaction. We have no reaction here because when we combine these two sets of ions, we just get the sets of ions floating around separately. There's no solid that's ever formed, so it's not a precipitation reaction. Thanks for watching this episode of Real Chemistry. We've learned about precipitation reactions, how you can combine two aqueous chemicals and get a solid chemical. And we've talked about the rules you need to predict those products. If you have any questions, please ask them below. Also subscribe to receive updates about future videos.